Okay. So,
do you want us to start a week two folder?
Oh yeah, let's go ahead and do that. So I think that'd be a good idea. So CD into whatever directory you're kind of where all these files are living. Yeah, I think this is a good way to organize stuff, you know, a week by week. So I'm going to do a make dir, so make directory week two. And then I CD, I can actually just type two and hit tab and it will like find that directory. I can CD into that. And oops, I'm gonna just like, let's see, for this maybe I'm just gonna make, or let's just touch a file. Let's create a file. I'm gonna call this just, let's call this monday.js. I don't know, you can call it whatever.
But quick question, what does the touch do compared to the make dir?
Yeah, so there are there's like a couple terminal commands I feel like you should have memorized or, you know, get familiar with. Maybe I'll create a list of these. And also Henry has a intro to the terminal video. So if you're feeling a little unfamiliar with the terminal, I'll throw that out in Slack. But let's just go over a couple, some terminal stuff really quick. So first of all, CD, that stands for change directory. This allows us to navigate, you know, to different directories in our, in our file system. So make dir, that is make directory. So that is a way I can create a directory. It's like coming into like, you know, my computer and right clicking and saying new folder. So that just makes a folder within the folder I'm at. So if I do it, I can also do an ls. That's like a list. It's saying, hey, list the contents of this directory. So in my week two directory, I made a Monday, I touched monday.js. So that just creates a new file. I mean, it's a, I don't know why it's touch, but it just creates a file. If I want to delete a file, I can do a rm and then give it the name of the file. Now, if I do an ls, it's there. If I do a touch like dot, you know, or some file, I have a dot in front of it. I do an ls. I don't see that file, but if I do an ls-la, there it is. So the ls-la, what it shows me is it shows me, I mean, these are like if it's executable, readable, writable. We don't really need to worry about that right now. But it also shows me hidden files. So if I have a dot in front of it, that means it's a hidden file. Yeah, so inside of here, I can make a directory, you know, another, whatever, dir. If I do an ls, now I have another dir in there. So I could like touch. So notice right now, if I do a print working directory, a pwd, that's saying, hey, here's the directory you're in. So I could create a file. I'm going to touch. I could create a file in this another directory. So if I do an ls, there's my directory. If I cd into that, an ls, there's that file I just created. If I want to remove a directory, I'll do rm another dir. This isn't going to work. It's going to say, hey, this is a directory, so I can do a rm dash r for recursive. So this is, that's going to say, hey, delete all the files inside of there. and that deletes that folder, and it deletes all the directories in that folder. Who here has done this? I mean, let's just, I'm going to throw a repo inside of here, and I'm going to do a git add, git commit. Who here has like done a git commit and you forgot the dash M and you like got into this?
I've had that happen.
And you're like, what the hell is this? How do I get out of here?
Normally, if anytime I get an error, I just push the up arrow to get the code I got back and checked it to make sure it's right.
Yeah, this is not an error.
Oh, it's not an error.
No.
No, I thought it was an error. So when I got it, I just redid it.
Yeah, this is, so we forgot the message. When we commit, we need to have a message. And if you see right here, it's saying git vi. So this is a program on your terminal called BIM. So I can actually come in here. So like, I want to type a message, but Vim is like, it's a text editor within your terminal. And it's got some like weird key commands. Like I can't use my arrows. I want to like type a message, but if I try typing, it doesn't work. I actually have to hit I. Like I come in here, I hit I to start typing, and now I can start typing a message. So that puts me, notice here, I'm in like insert mode. So now I want to get out of, now I want to like exit out of here. And this is like, there's like memes on the internet, like how to, like you get stuck in Vim if you don't really know what it is. So I want to exit out of Vim. So it's kind of weird. I need to hit the escape key. So now I'm out of insert mode. And then I need to do a shift colon. Now I can like, now I have a command prompt down here and I can do like a Q for quit. I can do a W for like save, or I could do like a WQ for write and quit. And that commits it. So I could do, I could, so in my file, or wait, I deleted it. I could touch, you know, demo.js. I do an ls, there's my demo.js. I could edit it inside of this terminal. I could say vi demo.js. Now I'm editing this demo.js file. So I could hit I to be in insert mode. Now I could do a console.log. Yo, yo, yo. Now I want to save this. So I hit escape to get out of insert mode. I do a shift colon. So I get that prompt down there, and then I can do a write quit. Now I can run that node demo.js, and there's that log. I can also open this up in VS Code. There's my demo.js, and there's the text that I just added in Vim. So, quiz, if you get stuck in Vim, how do you get out of Vim?
Control C.
Q.
What?
Yes.
Q.
If, escape and then Q.
Yeah, it kind of depends what mode you're in. So if my answer was, if you get stuck in Vim, the way you get out of it is you Google, how do I get out of Vim? So, and because you might, you know, I'm sure you're going to forget these commands. So that might happen. Sometimes you might also see, I wonder if I can like show this. If like I do a git log, I wonder if I can. Sometimes you'll see in your like, you get into terminal where you run a command and you kind of see like this end and you're like, where the hell am I? You can't get to the next prompt. Like, for example, I did a git log just to see the log messages. And now I can't get out of this like prompt, and I have this colon. So here's just another, it's kind of like a text editor. So it's not a text editor, but to get out of this, I can hit Q. So if you ever see that, that's like another one you can kind of get stuck in. So if you type git log, you might, it's going to like open up that, it's kind of opening up this less thing. And it won't let you like add changes here, but you want to get out of here, you just hit Q. Cool. So there's a quick little intro, some terminal stuff. We'll do a lot more terminal stuff just as the course goes on. But yeah, so some commands you should be familiar with: cd, makedir, touch, rm, rm-r. And then I'm just going to say no about Vim so you can Google it. So you're aware of what to Google for now.
James, can you go over how to remove a key if you accidentally made one inside of like a subfolder?
Remove a key?
A repository key? Because I made like a week one, and then I made a React folder, and then inside of that folder I had like another React project. So both of those have keys.
Oh, they have, you mean repos?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. So I actually want to do this here because now in this week two directory, I have a Git repository. I don't want that. So let me just show you what the Git repo is. If I do an ls, I have that demo.js, but if I do an ls-la to show those hidden contents, I have this .git folder, and the color that it's blue, that lets you know it's a folder. So I can do like a makedir folder here. I can touch a file, file here, .txt. I'm just kind of showing you the highlighting. Do an ls-la. So my files are going to be grayed out. My folders are going to be like this blue color. So I have this .git folder. So the dot just means it's hidden, and the git is a folder. So what I want to do when I initialize a git repository somewhere I don't want, I just need to find where this folder is and I need to remove it. So to remove a folder, that's the rm-r. I wonder if this one might make me do an F. Yeah. So this one, it's going to ask, hey, do you want to override all of these things? And I don't want to go through all this. So I can do a rm-rf. So that stands for like recursive and force. It's like, hey, just go and yes, I want to delete everything. Now I can see the git is gone. I can do an ls-la and that .git directory is gone. Cool. Sweet. So yeah, I would say this week, I think this is a week to, get more comfortable with some tools like the terminal and GitHub and Git. It's kind of, we'll not go into any more new things. We'll just kind of focus on React, JavaScript, Git, and let's throw on the terminal there. So we want to just get, good with the basics of terminal. Sweet. So I do an ls, and I want to remove that file here. Like I could just come into VS Code and, delete this. That's like doing a rm, .sumfile.txt. But try doing stuff you know, in your terminal. Cool. So what I want to talk about today with JavaScript is, because since we're going to be doing CRUD actions, so let me just open up this file. So CRUD as an acronym stands for Create, Read, Update, Destroy. And just think about like a website or an app and think about how common these actions are. Like, let's just think about Facebook. I could go in to Facebook and I could write a post. That would be creating a post. I could go to Facebook, and when I go to facebook.com, it loads that wall of all the posts. That's like getting the post. That is the read. It's like displaying. I'm just gonna throw like displaying. Another kind of word you can think about that one. Update, I can go in and I write a post. I, you know, have a spelling error. So I can go in and I can update that post to fix like the spelling error. Or I said something a little like political and off color. I can go in and I can destroy a post, kind of. I can go destroy from the database. So those are our CRUD actions. And, you know, I think you can think about like a lot of things online and just how often they've kind of, you have these actions on, you know, objects like that. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to kind of do some CRUD action type stuff. So when we're talking about this with, you know, React and JS and like, I want us to think about state. There's going to be a rule. There's kind of going to be like, you can't mutate state when doing this. So we'll look at what that means as we just go through like a JS demo. So let's go through. And even without React, let's kind of start thinking about our to-dos. And for this, we're going to be working with an array of objects. It's a very common thing that we're going to get back. Because like once we start working back with databases, you know, this is largely what we're going to be getting back. I had you for the homework. I think it was just an array of strings, right? That's what we did for the homework.
Yeah, that's what you had put into the Slack when I had asked a question about it.
But yeah, what if we wanted to like, how do I keep track if like this is done or not? Or like, you know, yeah, we'll just say something as simple as that. Like I have to-dos, how am I going to, you know, see if something's done. I could like remove an item, but maybe I still want to see it and like have like a checkbox or like a line through it to see that like it's still in my list, but it's done. So
you still want to keep it in that array?
Yeah, I would still want it to be there, but like I want to know that it's done, or like I want it to have that like done or not state. So yeah, a string is not really a data type we can do that with, right? I could maybe like append. I could say like eat is done, and then I could like, you know, change the string. I could do that. That would work, kind of. But a better way to do it would be to use a object. So I could have something like the, you know, the to-do would be eat. So that's the string, like the to-do is eat, and then I can have like a complete Boolean, like a completed. And then I can say that's false. So I can also do, you know, and then this is how, so all of my to-dos are going to have a to-do key and a completed key. And then completed is, we'll say this one's true. So now I have a way, hey, this, you know, I have this to-do of eat and it is not complete. I have a to-do of sleep and it is complete. So now I have that information. Something else we're going to see very commonly, like the majority of times, is, you know, when we have these objects, they're going to have IDs. And IDs are going to be a number and they're going to be unique. This is like when we get to like a database, we'll see this. And this is a way to, like, they're going to be unique identifiers. So you would never expect to see a to-do inside of here with, you know, another to-do with ID one. So it's a way to have a unique way to, like, identify these things from each other. And then, yeah, we can add some more. So this would be like 3 code. Sweet. So let's go through in JavaScript, in vanilla JS, do CRUD actions on this. So let's start with create. I'm just going to hard code a to-do. So I'm going to say const, you know, new to-do. And I'll just copy this one. Sweet, there it is. I have this new to-do object, you know, that has the ID to-do and completed. Now, what would happen if I did something like this? Does this to-do look like these to-dos?
They wouldn't be associated with the to-dos on the top.
Yeah, I mean, our key, the names of our key are going to get off, and then I'm not going to be able to do, like, they become ununiform. So, like, part of the, like, one of the keys here is that we have the, you know, we make sure that our keys are the same, like the name of the keys. So we have this uniform, like we have an array of uniform objects. So I have an array of to-dos, and a to-do has a name key, it has a completed key, and it has an ID. And name is a string. Completed is a Boolean. So this is like I'm being aware of the types. An ID is a number, and it's also unique. It should be unique. So those are some assumptions I'm making about my to-dos. I'm making, so I need to code those so I can keep that assumption. Cool. So now I can do I can add this to my array. How do I add something to an array?
Push.
Push. Yes, let's push it. So push. This new to do. And then we'll console.log to do's. And then I can run this node demo.js. Sweet. And that works. And
so anytime you wanted to add to your to do list, you can always just do a push like that.
Well, one second. This works for this case, but when we get to React, this is bad. Right, I should say this is bad for React. React state. The reason why is React state. We do not want to mutate.
Like what you don't mean to mess with the original.
Yeah. So what I'm going to say, I'm going to call this original to-dos, just so we can have some clearer names. And let's do a lit log right here. Original to-dos. So as we do CRUD, as we do all of these actions, this should not be changed. Now, I don't want to say like push, like this is always bad. The way we did this to push that was the correct, like that was a correct answer. Let's push the new to-do on the to-dos array. That's fine. That added it to the original to-dos. But when we're working with React and we're working with React state, we can't do that because that mutates original to-dos. So this should not change. So how do I add a to-do? What I need to do, and for all these actions, what we're going to need to do is I'm just going to create a new array and then add the to-do on that new array. So we need to clone to-dos and add new item or new to-do to clone. So that's going to be, so I can say like let, you know, new to-dos, because it's going to be a new array. I'm going to clone my original to-dos. Boom. That this dot, 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 that's the spread operator we learned about last week. That's just going to copy those arrays to this new array. And then I can add my new to-do at the end or at the start.
Now, could you use a plus sign and do it that way too, or it would kind of just mess it up?
A plus sign?
Yeah, where the comma after to-dos is between to-dos and new to-do.
Yeah, no, you cannot do that.
All right.
Yeah, so just think of like this dot, dot, dot origin to-dos. It's just taking that array and then it's plopping that there. And then like I'm following the syntax of an array. So the new to-do is really just that. Boom, there's my new array. It's got those three items in it. So now when I run this, my original to-dos is unchanged and my new to-dos has the item added to it. So this is create. You're gonna be doing a lot of this, like the dot, 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 copying the array and then adding a thing. If I want to add the new to-do to the start, well, that's pretty easy. I just add it here, comma, and then spread out over. So I can kind of change the, like now code's at the start.
Hold on, mine didn't work. What did I do wrong?
I'll select this out. I guess Slack's still down for some people.
It was working for me a minute ago, so it should. What did I do wrong?
Any questions on this, though? I'm going to skip over read for a second. Let's just go to update. Let's do update. And update, you know, you could see, I want to change the whole to do. I want to change the to like the name. Let's just do a demo of like of for this example, we'll just say toggle complete. So this I want to like go through and I want to update this array. So I want to say one thing's complete because we can think about like in our website, someone's going to click like sleep and we'd want to go in and like toggle that to false. Or if it was false, we'd want to toggle it to true. So if I told you, like if I just gave you this question, like not worrying about mutating anything, I want to switch this to false. Right here. How would I go in and take this original to-dos array and toggle completed on sleep to false?
Would it have something to do with one because that's number one in that array?
Yeah, that's the first thing. So console dot, let's just log it. So I could grab my original to-dos. And then I could grab that first thing. So that's a good first little step. Cool. So I grabbed that first to do. I'm gonna get rid of these logs too. So. So now that I have this, that's the first thing. How do I toggle this complete to false?
It wouldn't be an if else statement, right?
No, I can just do it right here. This is like this one. It's probably a lot simpler than you might think it is. I could just do dot completed equals false, right? So I could log my to-dos. I could go in, you know, I could find that to do and just set completed equal to, you know, false.
Okay.
Or I could also go in and say, hey, take that original to do, set the completed Boolean to the opposite of what that completed value is.
And that's what that exclamation point is doing?
Yeah. So here it's, when we log it first, the completed is true, but then after we run it and log it the second time, the completed is false.
Which way do you think is better to do it?
What do you mean?
Because you did it with the exclamation point, and then you did another one where you did equals false. Or it doesn't really matter.
Oh, no, it definitely matters. So it depends. If I know I want this to be false, I should say false. But if I want to toggle it and say I don't know the value, I just want to negate the value, then I would use this. Because this way I know if it's... If it's true, it's going to set it equal to false. If it's false, it's going to be equal to true.
Yeah, that's the that's what the video had me do yesterday that I watched for my to-do list. Cool.
So yeah, but this one is also, you know, another thing we might have to do. Well, let's just leave it like this, and then we'll kind of show why. This is bad, right? Because this is changing our state, right? It's changing the original to-dos.
Right, you want it to change the clone.
Yeah. So this one is not what we want to do because it mutates the original to-dos. So this mutates. Original to do, which, you know, that might be fine in some case, but with React, that's not going to be what we want to do with our state. So that's not good. So we need to do it another way. So we're going to want to create a new array, right? So I want to go through this array and I want to update it. When you think I want to go through an array and update something in that array, you should think of the map method. Because the map method goes through an array and it gets you back something different than the original array. It goes through each thing, gives you back something different. So let's actually, I'm kind of working on this little visualization app. Kind of showing you what map, let's write it out and then let's go look at it. We'll look at that like visualization. So here's what I'm going to do with the map. I'm going to say let updated to-dos equal. I'm going to go through my original to-dos and I'm going to do the map function. So with this, we give it a function to run on each item in the array. So I'm going to just call that to-do. And I'm going to see, hey, like, let's say I want to update the one with ID 2 like I did in this one. I can do this. I'll do this in a couple lines. So I'm going to say if to-do dot ID, right? Because all my to-do should have an ID. If this equals, I'm just going to hard code this like 2. Return. Let's look at what this is going to do. Completed. To-do dot completed. Return to do. And let's just see if this is working, and then we'll kind of discuss what's going on here. So here's my, and I'll throw in some better logs so we can see what these are. You know, spending a little time to like make your logs more readable, I think can help you kind of see what you're doing better. So here's my original to-dos. So my ID 2, when I first do it, it's completed is true. So this is after I create this, do all this stuff. So that's unchanged, but the updated list, that one completed has been toggled and everything else has been unchanged. So who thinks they can explain what's going on with this?
I think I can to a certain extent.
Yeah, you want to give it a go?
So you created a new variable named updated tools, and that's what you're going to console log at the very bottom towards the end after this is all complete. Mm-hmm. The original to-dos map is you taking, if you scroll to the very top, you should have one called original to-dos.
Yep.
And you're creating a map out of it. And then that next part to it, to do, you haven't assigned that yet, but you're going to assign that later on towards the bottom. And now if you
do... What do you mean assign? I'm going to assign this to do?
Well, like it when it's up there, it doesn't have an action yet until you call it at the bottom, right?
No, this right here, this, see where it's like pink?
Yeah.
This is a function. This is an anonymous function. You can think of this as a function definition.
Okay. So that to do function is saying that if the to do ID is equal to the second ID, then return a clone of to do and have it completed has opposite of the boolean, because the boolean was true, so it'd be opposite, so it'd be false, and that's why it's returning false. And then at the end you just return to do and it doesn't.
Cool. Yeah, so yeah, that's pretty good. So yeah, if my to do ID equals the thing I want, like, and this would be like the thing you want to update, and you know, because I could add some more to do's in here. Taco. So what it's going to do is only for that one ID that I want to update, it's going to go in, it's going to clone the to-do. So it's going to keep the ID and the like the to-do string the same, but it's going to update that completed Boolean. It's going to toggle it. And so it's going to update. That's like where the one actual thing is getting updated. If it doesn't match the ID, I still need to return the to-do just as is, because that's going to get plopped into the new array.
So it recognizes the completed at top, like when you put completed, and then it recognizes it from the first, from that array?
Yeah, because what map does, map goes through each thing in the array. So what it's going to do, it's going to go through this thing first. It's going to say, hey, like this to-do.id is one. Does to-do ID equal, does one equal two? No, it doesn't. Hey, just return this to-do as is. So then we go to the next thing, the next to-do. Does this ID equal two? Yes, it does. So go and copy this, make a clone of this array or this object. But then have the completed be just the opposite of what the completed is. So it's going to toggle, it's going to update and toggle this completed. I could also come in here and say like, hey, change the name or change the to do. I can change more than one thing. So if I run this now, the ID is still two, but now this to do is changed and the completed has also been changed. You know, I could say the completed is like whatever.
Now you said that's not good to do though, right? Because you're mutating it.
This wouldn't be good to do because now completed is a string and not a Boolean. So now completed is a string where these other ones are like, I want completed to be true or false. And for this one, just the demo, it's like, I want it just to negate the value. So this is just a little shortcut to do that. So let me do this. I made a little React thingy. I want to like see if we can visualize this and see if it can maybe make a little more sense. Let me try doing this really quick for this specific example. Okay. One second, I kind of have to like set this up. So I'm gonna throw in our, what I have here is I just have a way, like a little, I made a little component to kind of like visualize this. Give me a second. How am I going to do this? Let's take a break. Give me like 2 minutes to, or this is going to take me like a minute to kind of figure out. So take a break, try to, kind of look at this, and then when we get back, I'm going to have this set up so we can kind of like visualize this through like a stepper.
Okay, sounds good. So 10.
When do you want us back?
I'll give you let's give you like a 10:45. Give you 12 minutes.
Okay.
See you then.
The last part you slacked was just the very end of that whole teaching that you were just doing?
Yeah, that's like the update thing.
So we can just add that at the very bottom of what you had Slack the first time?
Yeah.
All right. But yeah, I am starting to understand functions a little bit better. I can at least understand what's going on.
Cool. Okay. So let's look at this example kind of through, and this is definitely, I just kind of did this yesterday. It's a little work in progress, but I hope this kind of shows, what I'm trying to show is what's going on in the map function. So what I have right here, this is just like some hard, like the code that we're going to run. So we have our, you know, our original to-dos, and then I'm just rendering them right here in this UI. So we can see these match and kind of doing them as boxed. So they kind of look like, you know, like this is an array. So what we're going to do is we're going to run through this map function. And what this is trying to visualize is, you know, it's going to show which to-do we're on and what this map function's doing. So when I hit click, it's going to start going through the map function, or like kind of simulating that's going through the map function. So notice with this one, we're going to check to see if the to-do ID equals 2. That's the one we want to toggle. And as we go through the map, what we do is we go through each thing, we run this function, and then we return that value. So as we're going through this one, we start with this first ID. And actually, I'm going to like change this so it goes like super slow. Like 10 seconds. Like 10 seconds on this first time. Okay. So yeah, we're on this first to-do and we're checking to say, hey, does this ID equal 2? It doesn't. So it just threw that to-do as is in this map array that what I'm saying, it's like building this return value. We go to the second thing, it runs this function. This ID does equal 2. So notice how that one, the complete, that one was toggled. The completed was false. And then we get to the third one. That one was just the same. So it just returned the to-do. So that one, just push it on. This one's unchanged. So that one's just returning the to-do. For this second one, we actually, this, the ID is 2. So that one, we actually are going to switch to completed. Notice how it's true here, but here, this one is false. So that's the one thing that was changed here. And then once the map function is done, this is the final return value. So this is what gets stored in this variable. So that's what, when you think about the map function, that's what it's doing. It's going through each thing and it's running this function. So we're on this object, let's run this function. It does not equal 2, let's just return the ID to that new array that we're currently building. Well, now we got to do it on the next thing. Okay, let's run that function. This one is ID 2, so let's return the new to-do with the completed vaults. Does that kind of help visualize that? Probably eventually throw this up online. So next we're going to do a filter. So what filter does, it does the same thing as map. It goes through each of our to-dos and then we pass it a function. So this function, here's the function I'm going to pass for filter. I just give it a function that takes it to do. And this function needs to return true or false. If it returns true, it's going to keep it in this new array that it's building. If it returns false, it doesn't keep it. So for this, I'm filtering over my to-dos and I'm saying, hey, as long as the to-do ID does not equal 2, keep push it into that new array that we're building. So this would be like, I go to my UI and I click on the to-do that has ID 2. And I say, I want to delete this to-do. So I'm going to use the filter method. to do that. So I can run through this.
How come you're only using two equal signs on that, not equals?
This is a triple equal because I have a not double equal.
Okay.
So that's actually a triple equal.
Oh, okay.
Quick question. So when you're actually doing that, though, you wouldn't want to hard code like the ID too, right? It'd be like if you were to click it and complete it, then you wouldn't want that to show.
Yeah. And we'll definitely get to that. Cause yeah, we don't want to hard code to, likewise, we don't want to hard code to here when we update it.
Okay. Yeah.
We're going to need to, when we click the button, we're going to need to pass the ID of the thing that was clicked.
Right. Okay.
So that's what's going on with the filter. So that one, you know, this ID does not equal 2. So push it onto the array. This ID is 2. That is, so this function returns false. So we do not want to push this one onto that new array. This one, this function does return true. So we can push that on. So when we filter, the final return value just has all of our to-dos minus the one that has the ID of 2.
So all you're looking for in the filter is ID 2 to match up with how you put it at the bottom left. And then if you wanted to do ID 3, you could do, or ID 4, for example, you do ID 4 and it would take the taco one instead.
Yeah, but filter, more importantly, the function you give it, just think of the, you pass it, this is a function, right? This function takes it to the to-do param and it checks to see if the ID key equals 2 or not. So if this function returns true, we keep the thing. If it returns false, we don't. I wonder if I have like another, let's look at this filter example. So here's another example of filter. I have an array 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's the array. I give it a function. What is this function saying? I mean, it's in the name, but I'll... You saw it. Like, just look at that highlighted code. What does this, tell me what this function does. I'll just write it out in VS Code. I'll just copy and paste it.
Is it taking the number, returning the number times 2? Like, I'm on my phone at the moment. I can't really see this.
Okay. Fx. Here's my function, or let's just do const x equals that.
Oh, it's dividing it by 2.
It's saying it's that's an remainder, odd right? number.
It's saying yes, what?
It's even or odd.
It's an odd number.
Yeah. So what if I do x of 1? What is this going to be? Like, what actual value is x of 1?
That should be true or false, but I'd say it'd be, since it's 1, it wants you to. It'd be false.
Yeah, that one's false.
And then the 2 would be true because it's a Boolean because you have the exclamation point.
Yeah, so that returns true. So this, what I'm showing is this function that I passed inside of the filter method, it takes a number and see if it's divisible by 2. If it's divisible by 2, it returns true. If not, it returns false.
Wouldn't it return...
And I have an array of numbers, so I can pass this function because it takes, you know, it can take a thing of numbers. So when I run this, you know, 1 is odd, right? So that function returns true. So that pushes it onto that, you know, array that it's currently building. So now we're on 2. 2 is not odd. So it doesn't push on 2 to that new array. We get to 3. 3 is odd. That returns true. Or I should say this function returns true. So it returns the number. It pushes the thing on the array. We get to 5. Or we get to 4. 4's that will evaluate false. So we don't push on 4.
So it's returning all the false numbers that isn't true to the function?
No, it... If this, so filter says, hey, if the function you give me returns true, keep the thing.
Oh, okay. So I just said it opposite, basically.
Yeah. Yeah, you said it reversed. But okay. Yeah, so my the final return of this one is going to be 135. So it's going to be a new array with all the odd numbers, you know, removed. But we can also do filter like we did right here to check, you know, hey, does like the ID of an object equal something? I could do a filter, you know, to say, hey, just remove all the things that are completed. You know, so it just as long as that function returns true or false. Let's see. I guess we can skip reduce right now. Kind of leave reduce alone. I think this is really useful for reduce, but we'll talk about reduce later. Just to kind of like, so to actually build this out, I don't want to get into the code too much. I just want to say like, to really do this, I had to use, this would have been very hard to, like I'm pretty much using reduce for all of these functions, like for all of this, but I'm just kind of pretending it's a map. But anyway, just showing you like reduce is by far the most powerful because you can do map, you can do filter, you can do for each with reduce. Anyway, but does this help like visualize what map is doing and what filter is doing?
Yeah.
Yeah,
we'll kind of go through this more as, yeah. Because I think if you can visualize what the functions, like what they're doing, then it's easier to code. So we talked about filter really quick. We actually didn't code it. So let's say I want to remove a item. So now that we've kind of seen it, let's do filtered views. This is going to be equal to my to-dos, or I'm going to take my original to-dos and I'm going to call the filter method. And I want to give it a function that takes a thing. I'm just going to call it X. What am I expecting X to be? Like, what is this X?
Would X be the whole to-do list?
It's not the whole to-do list. It's
the filtered to-do list?
No. So filter is going to return the filtered to-do list. What is X here?
Is it that defining the function?
That's basically what you're going to use to determine whether or not something gets returned, right?
So this pink thing, the thing I'm highlighting, that's the function. This is like the function definition that I'm passing to the filter, but what is X?
It's just a parameter.
Yes, that is true. It's a parameter. What would I expect X to be?
It would return the filter for you.
It's not doing. Yeah, it's not. I'm not. It's just a parameter. It's not returning anything.
It's the prop. I don't.
It's not.
That would be the ID or like any value of one of those.
You haven't defined it yet, so it can be anything at this point.
It's going to be something very specific though. X is, or what can I treat X like? And just watch, when I hover over X.
Is it going to be an object?
It's an object, but look at what VS Code is telling me. It's a parameter, but it's saying, hey, X has an ID, it's an object that has an ID, which is a number, it's a to-do, that's a string, and it's a completed, which is a Boolean. So X is one, like it is that object. It knows, because let's do this. I'm gonna write a function const is ID 2. Is ID 2. Here's my function. This takes in, you know, whatever, turkey. So I can say if turkey dot ID equals 2, return, let's spread out over turkey. I don't know why I always use turkey. And then completed, it's gonna be not turkey.completed. Let's return turkey. Maybe I should call this like update if. Update if ID 2. That's my function. Takes in a turkey, checks to see, hey, does that turkey ID equal 2? If it does, copy that turkey object and then have this completed key be whatever turkey.completed was not. If it doesn't, just return to turkey. So if I do let y equal that, what's going to happen if I run this code?
It's going to do the same thing that it's doing up above you.
So don't, let's just, so I don't know. So when you say above, let's say this is the endpoint of this code.
So both of those are the same, right?
Wait, what do you mean both of these are the same?
The let y equals updated if ID 2 is just a function, but you put it all together and compressed it, and now it's right there?
Not quite sure what you're saying.
Are you multiplying it? So it'll run twice?
No.
You're passing 2 in where turkey as a parameter?
Yeah, I'm calling this 2 and I'm passing 2. So remember, this is a function definition. And this is where, like, here I'm calling the function. And let's also do this console.log turkey. So maybe I can ask.
So you can put anything as a parameter as long as you call that parameter, right?
Yeah, I can put anything as a parameter, but what is going to happen when I run this?
The if statement's going to be true, so it's going to return you an array of objects, turkey, where the second ID is opposite of what it was.
Let's run this. Actually, and let's also console.log y. So we can see that value. So we log turkey. Turkey is 2, I guess. So I'm surprised this didn't break. How does that not break? How does 2.id not cause an error? I was really expecting this to break. But I don't know. I'm getting an unexpected result because I'm passing two to this function, and I'm trying to say like turkey.id. So I think like for JavaScript, this is kind of like a little strange. Let's like pass like a string in here. This will break it for sure. I don't know why the number's not breaking it. What the heck? How is that not breaking it? Oh, that's undefined. Okay. So I do asdf.undefined. The point here is turkey is whatever. So here's my definition. So turkey is going to be whatever I pass the function. Pass it in an array. That's kind of weird because it's just like just get rid of that ID. And what the heck? Okay. This is stuff you don't want to do anyway. Like what? Like turkey should not, like I should not be passing this function a string or in an array, right? Why not?
Well, is it because you're looking for the ID and the ID is not a string or anything, it's a number?
Yeah, that's close. It's if I'm saying like, okay, so I have this parameter, I'm calling it turkey, and I'm using just like just a random name that doesn't really mean anything. Because if I'm calling dot ID, what am I expecting turkey to have?
You're expecting it to have an ID.
Yes. So what I'm really expecting, you know, I need to pass this a function that has an ID field. And since I'm comparing to see if it's equal to two, well, that probably expecting that to be a number.
Right.
So let's go back. Oh, let's actually have this now take an object with an ID, console.log x. Let's maybe have this equal to two now, so it updates. Why is completed true on this?
Because you had it, if it does have ID of two, you want it to be the opposite of what it was. So was it, let's see, originally it was false, so it changed it to true.
I never passed this. This ID does not, like I never passed this a completed, right?
But you did it inside the function. You wanted it.
Yeah, right here. So why is turkey dot, like this doesn't have a completed key on it.
Is it because it's the third in the array, so it's equal to two, so you're turning turkey ID into turkey completed?
There's no array here.
No.
Oh, did it just append it? It just created one?
It does, it creates this completed field. Like I could say completed is here. That would definitely, you know, that's here.
Right.
But that's weird. Why is this turkey.com, this doesn't have a completed field. If I do right here, console.log turkey.completed. what is this going to log?
Undefined.
Yeah, that's going to be undefined. So that's undefined. Cool. Well, what is the value of not undefined? That's true. Because undefined is a faulty value. So we would negate undefined and that becomes true. So that's why the completed's true. But that's, you know, if the point here, like if I'm calling like turkey.id and turkey.completed, I should probably pass, those should probably be things I'm passing to this function call. Like I need to pass it an object that has an ID and completed field. And if I'm doing like a negation, well, that should probably be a Boolean of some sort. Let's say turkey dot. Sorry, I'm gonna get my syntax here. What do you think I should now pass or add to my object when I call it?
You need to give it X key.
X key. What type of data do you think that should be?
Be a number.
Yeah, a number, because I'm timesing. In this function definition, I'm saying, hey, take X, turkey.x, and times it by 2. Well, that's, I'm probably trying to time something by 2. So when I actually call my method, I should give that an actual number. And if the ID does not equal 2, let's have that equal 3. We just return the object as is. So there's my function, right? I'm going to get rid of these. Let's just do this. Now we saw this function, you know, can take a to-do object, right? And if the ID is 2, I declared that twice. Let's see why. If the ID is 2, it's going to like go update those fields in the object. If not, it just leaves it alone. So let's go ahead. I'm going to take this function and I'm going to plop it right here. So saying I can't access update I do. So this error, it's saying, hey, you're trying to use this function before you defined it. This is actually one of the difference between arrow functions and non. So I could fix this two ways. I could come up here and just define it before I use it. Cool. That works. Or if I wanted to leave it down there, I could use that like the function syntax. It's just a little like, I know we've seen these different ways to write functions, but, and I've told you they are more or less the same, but there are small differences between them. Filter to do. So I'm going to get rid of these logs because it's kind of messing everything up. so you can see this. I'm just gonna, if the idea is to, like, this is something you wouldn't want to do, but just to show, let's go ahead. So if turkey.id equals 2, I want to like come in and add this updated. Oh wait, I'm passing this the wrong function. Let me take this one. So here, here we pass it at a anonymous function. So I'm actually just going to pass this to the map. And then const.log here. Updated to do's. See how I can just, I can pass it this function that I said update if ID is 2. I can pass that function to my map directory directly. Or, you know, we just did it where we passed it the same function. We just didn't name it. We just directly passed a anonymous function there.
Wait, scroll back up to the top one again.
Actually, let me throw these in order so we can see it. So you can kind of compare side by side. So here I just gave it like a anonymous function. And I'll just get rid of that updated too, so they look the same. But these functions are doing the same thing. They're saying, hey, does the ID equal 2? If it does, spread out over it and then toggle the completed. See, I called this to do because that's a good name to call that parameter. But I can call it turkey. I can call it, you know, whatever. But I'm expecting it to have to be an object that has an ID, that has a completed Boolean. You know, it has an ID, it has a completed key.
So basically you're saying, instead of doing an anonymous function, you can create a function beforehand and pass that through map.
Yeah, it's the same. The difference, this function is, it just doesn't have a name. It's just,
yeah,
but that is a function, right?
Yeah, you just like made that on the fly, whereas on the other one, you...
This one, it has a name, but they both are functions that take one parameter and they're expecting that parameter, like they're treating it like it has an ID and it has a completed key on it. You know, with our ES6 stuff, I could just say, hey, don't take that to do, just take off the ID and the completed from that object. That would work. Just leave that though. So when I do the filter method, give it a function, and that function, what I'm expecting X to be, X is going to be the to-do that it's currently iterating over. So that has a ID. And for that one, I want to remove it if it does not equal 2. Because the filter method needs a function that takes an like the item in the array and then returns a Boolean. So let me ask you this. This is like so important to understand. So let's say I have a nums array, 1, 2, 3, 4. And I say nums dot filter. What? So there's my function. What type of data is Y going to be?
A number.
A number. It's going to go through this. It's going to go through each of my numbers. And Y is going to be the current thing it's going over. Y is going to be 1 the first time. Then Y is going to be 2 the second time. Then Y is going to be 3. So I could do something like this. I can say, you know, is Y greater than 2? That's all of these methods, the map, the filter, the reduce. You give them the function of what to do with the one thing in the array. So here's the function. Here's like the one we just did where it's odd. Hey, go through each num. Here's the, like, I'm giving you a function to run. Let's actually, let's do this. Because this is really important. And I have some videos on YouTube that I posted that actually like go through implementing like a filter method. Or like a filter. Let's implement the filter method to see how it works kind of behind the scenes. So I'm going to have a filter method that takes, you know, some array. Because what I want this filter method to do is, hey, you give me an array and you give me a callback function. Let's just say callback. That tells me whether or not you want to keep the thing. Let's say like the filter method didn't exist. So what I could do is I could do a for loop. Let's say we only have access to a for loop. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new array, let filtered array equal just a blank array. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through my array that was passed to me. So let's do let I equals 0, I less than array.length, I plus plus. And for now, let's just console.log array at I. So I can now call this filter method. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Big console here, console.log. Okay. So I have a filter method. So far, I can pass it in an array and it just goes through each of the things and logs the array. But now let's have it be able to pass it a function. Let me write this out as like is greater than, or let's just do like an is odd, a simple is odd function. This function takes a number. And it returns true if it's odd, it returns false if it's not. So take that number, you know, mod it by 2 and check to see, does that not equal 0? Let's make, and I'll say is even, and maybe this is more clear if it's even. So far, if the remainder of division by 2 equals 0, it's going to return true because that's an even number. So I can pass this function to my filter method. Notice I'm not calling my function. I'm passing it the function. Cool. Now in my filter method, so I'm in, like, I'm a JavaScript engineer guy. I'm like implementing JavaScript. I want to create this function, you know, that filters array, because that is something we do so much. We go through in an array and we want to like remove stuff from it. But as like the JavaScript engineer, I want to make this method, this filter method, be able to filter any kind of in an array, not just numbers, not just strings, not just like, it can filter any type of array. Well, how do I do that? It's like, well, the person who uses this method needs to tell me how to, like, whether or not they should keep this thing. So they need to give me a callback function that returns true or false. Because what I can do here is I can call their function that they gave me. And, you know, but I'm expecting it to return true or false. Does that make sense as far as like being the JavaScript engineer? Like, they can give me a function, but the function needs to return true or false, or else the filter method's not going to behave as I'm designing it. It's like if I'm designing a car and, you know, I'm saying, hey, I'm expecting this car to take gas, and you go and you put in water, like, you can do that, right? You can go put in water in your gas tank, but don't expect it to work. You know, you could maybe put in diesel. I don't know, maybe diesel is going to work. But like, you, as the designer of the like car, it's like, no, you need to put in like unleaded gasoline. And if you put in anything else, you know, well, it's, I can't guarantee it's going to work or not. So that's what I'm doing here as like the JavaScript designer. I'm saying, hey, you can give me a function and I'm going to call this function, but that function better return true or false. If it doesn't, don't expect this to work. What do you think I want to do right here? Any ideas?
Return something?
I don't want to return it quite yet. So, because remember, this callback, it's going to return true if they want to keep. So we're going to go through each thing.
So do you need an else statement for the, if it doesn't match?
And I'm also forgetting something very, very important right here. They're going to give me a callback, but what this callback needs to do is it needs to take the current thing I'm iterating over. And let me just put this in a variable so we don't have to say array at I. So current thing equals array at I, right?
So now when you call it back, you're going to use current thing rather than array I?
Yeah. I mean, that's just, I don't need to do that. That's, I'm just trying to make this more readable.
Right. I just wanted to make sure I was on the same page.
Yeah. And we saw the log. So the current thing is like, in this case, it's the current number.
So if it's true, you want it to loop through and return the numbers, right?
If it's true, I want, so they're giving me a callback that takes the thing and it's telling, if it returns true, I want to push the thing on that filter array. If this doesn't return true, I'm not going to push it onto this array. And then at the end of the for loop, I can return my filter. I'll call this filtered array. So that's, I'll go through each thing and then I'm going to call their function that they gave me that, you know, it's going to take that parameter. It's going to take the current thing I'm iterating over. If it returns true, so if that function call returns true, I push it onto the array. And then at the very end, I return that array. So now with my filter method, they can give me an array, and they give me a function. They give me an array of numbers, and they give me a function to perform on one number. You know, this function takes a number, and if the number's even, it returns true. Let evens equal, I can filter that, and then I can console.log evens. Reference array. So I got an error. Filter array is not defined.
Change inside the if statement. You didn't change it to filtered array. It still says filtered array.
And that's exactly it. So just showing you though, this is line 80. This one actually is telling me right where that error is. It's saying, hey, filter array is not defined. So now I can come in here and I can be like, oh yeah, I switched that to filtered. And then I can go run that again. Boom. There's my even array. But I've created this filter method. Well, sweet. Now I can come in here and I can do, well, maybe I want to grab odd numbers. And I maybe don't need to, you know, do a name function. I could just do one right here. Call that X. I could say, hey, X is just a number in this case, because I have an array of numbers, is X mod 2 not equal to 0. There's my odds. Broke this one again. Where's my error here? Evens, oh, declared that twice. That needs to be odds. So it's saying evens has already been identified, line 95. So I had evens there, so I need to switch that to odds. 24135. Sweet. Oh, so let's say they give me an array of to-dos that has an ID, that's a number, yeah, it's completed. As a, let's call that T, it's like eat. And I'll just call it C, true. So now I can take an array of objects that have, you know, ID, T, and C. And now I can take X, but now X, what is X now? What type of data is X?
It's a number right now.
No, it's not. Or like, I mean, really, it's anything. But
oh, what, it's an object now?
It's what, yeah. What am I expecting it to be? Like, is this is now not like the right type of operation, right? I could do x.id.
Yeah.
That works. To be an object. That's fine. Why not? I can go check and see if my ID is divisible by 2, because my ID is a number. What if I do like ID dot T mod 2?
I wouldn't be able to do it because it's not a number, right?
You can't divide a string.
Yeah, it's like trying to do modulus on a string. And once again, this is where you get into that area of like, I mean, it's working kind of, I don't know. I guess that is true. But this is like, you know, you have a car, I'm expecting gas, and you're giving me like Everclear. And hell, maybe it works, but maybe it's like it's gonna break, you know, the engine down the road. So this is why you gotta keep track.
That's gonna be a bug eventually, right?
Yeah. X.c. Is that valid?
Yes.
Yeah, because C is a Boolean. So this would just remove all of the C, like all of the objects whose C is false. So that'd be valid. I didn't save that. So yeah, so now this one's removed because C is false.
Why does it remove false ones?
Why does it remove false ones?
Yeah. I thought it would just remove anything that has x dot c.
No, this is the callback function that I'm passing this callback function to my filter method.
Right.
My filter method goes through each thing. It runs my function. This function is really just returning x dot c. So it's either returning true or false. So this function call, like, it's just saying, hey, if true or false, like it's a little, we run this function. It's just like kind of plops it right here.
Okay. I get it.
See, the current thing becomes X. X is like the thing.
Yeah.
And so if that just returns false automatically, so we don't push it onto the array.
Okay, I think I see it.
But you see how now, like, the benefit of this is I've now written a pretty nice filter function, right? This is pretty useful. I can give it an array, and I can give it a method to tell me whether or not to keep an individual thing. So now this filter method becomes really useful. And yeah, we don't have to write this because JavaScript already has this method for us.
So what is the function doing on the third one again, the let things?
This function? Okay, yeah. Let's write this
out. I understand the first one's doing is even and it's checking in. The second one is doing is odd. What's the third one doing again?
Okay, let's write this out as a function definition. So function taco. Actually, I mean, let's actually name this one what it is doing. It's actually really okay. Okay, let's like ignore all of this and let's just like look from here below. So kind of like clear your memory of what we've been talking about and just like focus on this one thing. That can be like a good little thing to do when you're coding, just when you can. If you can, just like look at just the one thing of code and be like, what is this doing? So what is this? First of all, this is a function definition. What type of object should I pass this function when I call it? I need to pass this a argument, right?
Yes, you need to pass it an object dot C.
Yeah, an object with a C key.
An object with a C key.
And it's kind of hard to tell what this type could be. It really could be any. It's but like well, let's just do this. I'm going to say let's call it foo, good old foo. What is foo going to be?
Would that be false because that's not a Boolean? Or would it be true because it does have a C key, technically?
But what is C? Let's just run it. Just S, just return thing dot C. C is the key, so grab me that value of C.
Okay.
S. So if I come in here and do like an array, now thing.c is an array. If I come in here and say C is true.
So could you say like, if something's truthy, that just means, that can also mean it just exists.
That's a pretty good way to think of truthy. Because remember, we have our falsy values, which are like zero, null, undefined.
Is NaN considered?
Yeah, NaN is falsy. It's kind of a good, like, that's kind of a good way to think about, you know, whether or not something's false. I mean, obviously false is falsy.
For some reason, it's just easier for me to understand it if I'm just questioning whether or not, like, it's been declared, or if it's like, if it, I don't know how to say it, but like if it actually exists, that's like the only way I can put it.
Yeah. So like, but what I want, like this is C, like I could define this in a function, or I can do like this shorthand. This is just a function that returns the x dot c value. This thing is doing the exact same thing. It just has a name. And the parameter is called thing. Here the parameter is called x. I think a nice thing about learning, like really getting clear with map filter, like these map filter for each. First of all, they're used quite a bit, especially with React, but they also like just to, I feel what happens, you know, and I've seen this with a lot of students when they're like kind of done with DPL, I still see them actually, they can write code that works with like map and filter, but I ask them like some basic questions about it and they can't answer it. So it's almost like they're getting into like definitely the copy and pasting and like fudging it to work, but they're kind of missing the understanding of it. So it's part of the reason I kind of wanted to start out with JavaScript first, is so we could spend, you know, a lot of time with this, like the first, you know, 2-3 weeks going through this with just JavaScript and React and no Rails involved. I think this is good for now. I'm going to slack out this example and then let's take a break. And when we get back, we can look at to-dos, like doing the to-dos in React. So we'll create a little React app and do the full CRUD actions on to-dos in React and kind of like applied what we learned here. Cool. Yeah, let's take a break. Let's come back at, let's just call it 12 o'clock. I'm gonna step away, but I'll be back in like, I'll come back like 5 minutes before 12. So if there's any questions, I'll answer it then.
Yeah, it sounds good.
Cool. Let's go ahead, get started. I am going to do a little Zoom poll. I'm just kind of curious about how you're feeling about the pace so far. I know it's just week one, but can everyone see that poll? Should be, because it should like pop up on your screen.
I see it.
Cool.
I do not.
Oh, you're on your phone.
On the Zoom screen?
Yeah, it should be on Zoom probably somewhere.
Okay, I'll look around. I don't know if I'm looking in the wrong spot or what, but I still don't see any poll.
Yeah, it's just like the how you're feeling about the pace of the course. Is it too slow, just right, bit much, way too much? It's anonymous, you don't have to say.
Mine just popped up right over my Zoom screen, like where his screen is shared. It popped up right over that.
Yeah, that's what I kind of figured would happen, but it, nothing popped up and I'm looking at my other screen and nothing's up there either. So I don't know what I did, but I don't have it.
It's fine. Looks like we have a pretty like a good old fashioned curve going on right here. We have one that says it's too slow. One says it's way too much. Five saying it's just right. And three saying it's a bit much, but it's okay. But I'm okay. So it sounds like it's probably about as, you know, I'd expect. It seems like maybe it, to me that like, I mean, obviously there's extremes, but it seems like it's about a good pace so far. So if you're feeling it's too fast, you can talk to me. I can maybe give you some more resources to maybe even get ahead. If you feel like it's going too slow, you know, I talk to me. I can maybe help with that. I can definitely give you more work. If you feel like it's going way too fast, also, yeah, let me know. And you know, how maybe you can get caught up, that kind of thing. And yeah, but if, for those of you who are like in the middle, I think that that's kind of, you know, what I'm shooting for. Either it's just right or it feels, I kind of think like it's just right or it feels like a bit much. That's kind of like what I'm expecting. So cool. Let's go ahead and go into React. So we're going to do a to-do list. With React, we're going to do the complete CRUD actions on the to-do list. Since we only have we have about an hour, so I might go a little quick through this just so we can get it done, because I do want to get this complete. So let's go ahead and get started. So let's CD into like your week two directory. And we're going to create a React app. So create, we got to do our yarn.
React. You're not screen start.
Oh, thank you. So yarn create React app. Let's call this to do CRUD. And this with us. Spring 22. So I'm going to build this out. You don't have to do this next step, but I'm going to create a GitHub repo for this. So put it to GitHub. I'll do a new repository. Go in, copy this name. Create the repo.
I just tried to do the yarn and it said that it couldn't find a package.json file.
Yeah, you need to yarn create React app and then the name.
Oh, I misspelled create. That's what I did. Okay.
Cool. So I will CD into that. I'm going to add the remote. Add dot git commit dash m in it. Origin master. Now, this is what I'm talking about. If you do this, your homework's not going to be late. Even if you forget to put the link in Neo, we can open it up and you can throw it in. But I now have this pushed up to GitHub. It's going to be like timestamped. So I'm like, we can be able to see like when you push this up to GitHub.
Is this file going to be a homework?
No. You don't have to push. You don't need to push this. You don't need to do the GitHub stuff.
You're just kind of showing us again, just for a refresher.
Yeah, and I'm doing the GitHub stuff because I actually, I'm going to throw this out in Slack, and now you can have a link to this demo.
Okay.
Cool. So I CD'd into that directory. I did added the remote, add, commit, and push. Could open this up into code. Sweet.
Mine didn't seem to work. Do I have to create a directory through my week two before?
No, you should not have. You should go. You should run that in like your week two directory. Let me Slack this out. Maybe there was a misspelling.
Okay, I'll try that.
You know, this yarn create React dash app that needs to kind of be exactly as is, and then that's just the project name.
Okay, yeah, that's working.
Cool. Sweet. I know for some, this can kind of take a second, so I'm kind of stalling. For that yarn create React app can take a second. While I'm kind of stalling, let me just show you just a little tangent side note. So all of your Git repositories are going to have these README files. So the create React app, we have that by default in your root directory in your project, you know, and that's what's showing up in there. So, you know, somewhere like maybe in your projects, if you want to, you can do like, you can start learning how to do some mark. So this is an ND file. It stands for Markdown. The Markdown language is pretty simple. You can just Google like what you can do. Like a pound is going to be like a header. Let's just do a quick, like this is a header. This is like 2 pounds is like a smaller header. So it's like that number of pounds is like how big it is. You can actually do like code snippets. This can be nice, like to write like little tutorials, like getting started. can do like three back ticks. And then this is going to be styled like terminal code. So you could do like a yarn. You can just like leave notes here.
So you just deleted all of your README notes and then just restarted typing?
Yeah. And this isn't like, I'm just kind of like showing you terminal commands. What markdown is, you can actually do like, you know, JavaScript code by doing the three ticks, saying JavaScript. It's going to format it like JavaScript. So it's not actually writing JavaScript, but it's going to show up as JavaScript, or like it's going to like format it like that. You know, and you can change like the languages. So, you know, I've made a change to this README. Maybe I want to push up the README now so I could do a git add dot git commit dash m. So a good message for this would be like update README, because that's what I did. And then I can push up to master. And see now like this is a way you can document your repos. So I have like that header, and you're doing it with markdown. So header, small header. Could like have terminal commands, see how it's kind of like formatted like that. It actually gives you like a, does it? I thought it gives you like a copy button. There's some JavaScript formatting, some Ruby formatting, it has all different kinds of languages. All right. That's your README file. It's really for documentation. Sweet. So let's go in and let's do our to-do list.
Quick question, James.
Yeah.
So are you saying every time you push to GitHub or push to Git, you should update the README?
I'd say it's for your...
Kind of like a one-time thing.
No, I mean like... If you have like a big project, I mean, let's look at like, I don't know. We might get into Axios today. GitHub. So if I was working on this project, you know, I like, here's their README. Like this is like, you can do links with the README. Like you're going to be just updating your README as your project's updating. Because this README is kind of like how you use this library.
Right, okay.
So for your homeworks, I wouldn't worry about it so much, but if it's like a project you might be showing to an employer or something that you've spent a lot of work on, yeah, you should change your README to explain what the project is.
Okay.
But yeah, just, a little side note while people's create React apps we're building. Okay, so now let's go ahead and actually start building our to-do list. So I'm just going to do this like this. I'm going to come in here and in my app, I'm going to get rid of all that. I'm going to come in here and I'm going to make a new file. I'm going to call this to-do list.js. Do list. Okay, so this is going to take our props. Now we're just going to return some JSX. So we're going to try to take what we learned just with CRUD actions on just, you know, JavaScript. And now we're going to try to, you know, use React to make this like an interactive to-do list. But I'm going to start small and we're going to kind of do a little review as we're going through React as well. So here's my React. I'm just doing a basic React component. Remember React, a React component's really just a, we're just doing functional components for now. So it's just a function and it's returning this JSX stuff. And remember JSX is a React thing. It's not HTML. It looks a lot like HTML, but eventually we'll get converted to HTML. But this is JSX. So I'm going to export default this to-do list. And now right here, I can go ahead and add my to-do list component.
Wait, what did you just do again? You were just on the to-do list, right?
Yeah.
Oh, and you put an export at the bottom?
Yeah.
So
I export. This is just, that simple stub dot. And this is how I really recommend you do this. You go in, you build your simple component, and then wherever you want to render it, you go render that component. And then terminal yarn start.
So on the top of apps.js, that's when you did the import?
Yeah, and remember with, so a couple things when you're importing, so you can do it manually to do list. I like to do like, so when I type from and I'm typing, the path, I really like to use VS Code. So I know I'm like, it's because it's going to tell me where I'm at. So I'm using VS Code to make sure I'm giving it the actual right path. The other way to do this is the autocomplete. So I just start typing like to-do list or start writing my component and then I can auto import it. And then close that out. Cool. So I can have multiple to-do lists.
So on my React, it's saying error in source app.js line 6034.
Yeah, you have a syntax error. So you have something, you're missing like a closing bracket. You're missing something. I'll slack out this app.js as is.
All right, thank you.
So hey, do you have some setting that's auto-centering your text?
Yeah, I do. I'll try not to do that. Sorry, I won't do that. I'll show you in like a week how to do that.
That's okay. I was just making sure that mine wasn't broken or something.
I like to format it just so when I slack it out, it's formatted.
Yeah.
But yeah, because I do
like on your if you go to your localhost 3000, like the div that you just made. Like
oh, you mean this? Page. Oh, you mean that? No, that
mine's not centering like that.
Well, yeah, because I have a class name app.
Okay.
That's doing that because it's importing that from app CSS.
Okay.
If I got rid of that. So yeah, we could just manually do that style. Do an inline style margin auto. So notice I can give this an inline style. So the first square brackets is saying, hey, this is going to be JavaScript. And then I need to give it a JavaScript object for the actual style. So I could do something like this, margin auto, and like max, give it a max width. So it's not like CSS, I'm not doing a max dash width because it's like a minus sign. Because this is JSX, so I have to camel case these things, 800 pixels. And yeah. Except that's not, yeah.
Got it. You could just do like text align center though if you want center.
Well, this is a div. So I'm centering the div.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, I'm not going to worry about styling. I'm just going to do this actually. I'm just going to do a margin cancels. There we go. It's fine enough for now. It's not. All right. So there's my to-do list, or there's the to-do list. I have that working. So let's talk about props. So I could give my to, like, let's say I maybe want to have two to-do lists, right? Because, or let's start kind of backwards. Maybe I want to have like coding to-do list. So I could like hard code this header to say coding to-do list. Sweet. And, you know, maybe I want like a, I don't know, like a gaming to-do list. So I could come in, I could create a new like to-do list, and so I could change the header, right? Well, a to-do list is going to have like the same functionality. I want to like add things to do. It might have like a topic or a header. So instead of just hard coding the name of the to-do list, I can make this as a prop. Like, hey, it's kind of like an argument to a function. It's like, I can make this a little more reusable by saying, hey, give me a name and I'll throw that name here.
What is that prop being used for?
The name, props.name.
But it's used so you can reuse the prop again, or?
I have a list. So one of the things with coding that is going to come in time and time again is I want to make something generic. I want to make this reusable. So I have a to-do list, and maybe I want to give the user the option to call the to-do list what they want to call it. If I say to-do list, if I hard code to-do list, they're stuck with that name. Maybe they want to call it like, you know, I don't know, give me an example of a to-do
list. So if they wanted a school to-do list, a gym to-do list, that's what it would be used for?
Yeah. So I'm saying, hey, you give me the, I'm telling them, like, this is me, like, I'm designing, this is like when I write a function definition. I'm saying, hey, like, you give me the name and then I'll put it here for you.
Okay.
So you're creating it so the user can basically put in whatever they want for that. And then that'll, it just
give formatted
whatever they want to put in.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So now when, so this is like, let's say like when I'm on this, like I'm like the to-do list engineer. And this is how, like, you know, would maybe be at like a job, like, you know, you're working with two people and like, someone's like, hey, James, will you build me a to-do list? I want to use it in my app in some other place. You build it and I'm going to use it. So, okay, I'm the to-do list engineer. I'm making it generic, like making it generic / reusable. So I'm going to say, hey, you can give this to-do list a name. So when the other coder uses it, they go, sweet, I'm going to use a to-do list and I'm going to give this a name of coding to-do list. And now they have a coding to-do list. And, you know, someone else, because, you know, maybe I want to have multiple to-do lists. This is like a, you know, pre-camping. What do I need to do before I go camping? Sweet. And there's the pre-camping to-do list. So now I can have multiple to-do lists. Exactly. And I'm going to do that with React. We do that with props.
I think it did mine. No, wait, never mind. I just had to save.
Cool. So something, what I'm going to do here, and this was like part of your homework, was now I want to render the to-dos. So, and with this, I'm just going to grab it now because I'm going to want it. I'm going to want state. Because eventually we're going to be changing. this state.
Real fast before we move far forward, is anyone else getting lag from James?
I just saw something pop up.
I was sliding for a second.
Yeah, it's kind of.
I just saw something pop up that says my internet's unstable.
Okay, I wanted to make sure it wasn't mine.
No, I got it too.
Okay.
Let me check something.
That's not great.
Let's see here. I thought pretty good internet. This happens time to time with Zoom.
Yeah, James, if you can hear us, your picture is completely frozen, and I think you're. Yeah. Oop, oop.
You could turn off your camera.
Yeah, let me try turning off my camera. I mean, I have good. Can you hear me now?
Still kind of spotty.
Yeah, it's cutting in and out.
I'm going to hop off and hop back on. Just do a good old session, one of those.
All right. Well, you shouldn't have issues. 217.
I think it's your upload speed. That's what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty bad. I'm going to hop off one second.
Okay.
And restart my internet.
I wanted to make sure it wasn't me before we got too far, and I was just like cutting out or something.
I'm going to make someone the host.